This is sufficient for me. Your strength is made perfect when I am weak. And all that I cling to, I lay at your feet. Your grace is sufficient for me. Grace is sufficient for me. Your strength is made perfect when I am weak. And all that I cling to, I lay at your feet. Your grace is sufficient for me. Grace is sufficient for me.
Your grace is sufficient.
Your strength is made perfect.
Yes.
When I am weak, all that I cling to, I lay at your
feet. Go ahead and lay it down at his feet right now.
Grace is right sufficient. Now. Grace is sufficient. Grace is sufficient for me. To see the Lord, the promised land, wherein all sins, pearly gates, look land. And what was once a pearl, mercy that blows away, that blows away in the light of him.
Good evening, and welcome to Hope in the Night. I'm your host, Miss Patricia. There we go. I'm going on camera tonight. Why not? Of course, I have my favorite shirt on. Repent. And we're talking tonight about compromise. I'm turning my phone off so I don't get text messages while I'm on the air. I checked it. They're not in trouble. It was just a conversation. With everything going on right now in this world, and there's a lot, there's things that we haven't even brought to your attention yet, because we're still checking them out. But with everything going on right now, what manner of person ought we be? That's scripture. Are we to be compromising our daily walk? Are we to be, you know, letting a little leaven in here, a little leaven in there, you know, yeast? Bible says a little bit of leaven, leaven at the whole lump. All you need is a little bit of yeast to make it blow out of proportion. A little bit of yeast, a little bit of sin. What manner of person ought we be? Knowing what's going on around the world and right here in the U.S. I'm going to go right to the Lord in prayer. Oh, Heavenly Father, we come to you, B'Shem Yeshua, in the name of Jesus. And we ask, Lord, that you would be with this program tonight, this meeting tonight, Lord God, that your word would go forth and it would accomplish exactly what it set out to do. Father, I pray that conviction would be upon the ears of everyone listening worldwide. But more than conviction, a decision to choose to walk the right way, to choose ye this day, this night, whatever time it is around you, where you are, who you will serve. It's time to get off the fence. It's time to walk, talk, think, do as the perfect example Messiah left us when he walked the earth. Father, I ask that you would give us the grace to obey your commands, to walk uprightly before our God. So that if, God forbid, this was our last day on the earth, we would be in your arms at the close of it. Father, please break up the fallow ground of our hearts. Unblock ears, uncover eyes, Lord, that your children would know the truth and the truth would make them free. And we'll give you all the glory and all the honor for it. Once again, in Jesus' name, Hashem Yeshua. Amen and amen. I'm going to go right to my notes here. If you see me looking down or looking around, I'm looking at my notes. I'm going to read my text. And we're going to have kind of a continuation of this on Friday night. It's going to be compromise in the church. It's going to be extended. Tonight it's compromise in our own lives. There's a lot of compromise going on in churches, which is dribbling into that the believer's life, or the new believer, the newborn Christian. They go into a church, and I have a few in mind in my area. They go into a church, and they hear secular music coming from the platform, when that platform is supposed to be consecrated for praise and worship of our God. They have a preacher preaching that we need to not judge the homosexual. We need to accept them just like they are, put them to work in the church, because they love God too. I know someone back in New York. She was a lesbian. She is a lesbian. She said so. She doesn't fulfill those desires. She stays by herself out on Long Island. She gets those feelings, yes. She's repented, and she goes before the Lord. But she's not going to sin. We'll be tempted, but it's up for us to cast down imaginations. And for a pastor to say, yip, yip, hooray, love one, when the Bible says that those that practice these things will inhabit the lake of fire if they don't repent. It's pastors like that that are leading the flock astray. So you want to listen on Friday night. Me and Brother Larry are going to have a lot of information for you on what to look out for. If you can't see it in your own church with what's going on, you need to get into that word so that the Lord can show you what the truth is, so that when you see a lie, you'll know the difference. And I would advise, probably get flack from that, if you're in a building and they're preaching the truth, great. But Saturday is the Sabbath, okay? That's the set apart day from the Lord. If you want to go to a Sunday church or a Monday church, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, whatever day you want to go ahead to prayer meetings. Go ahead. But make sure you are connected with someone preaching truth. Well, get out of there. And if you're not in a building right now, with the things that are going on, with the things that are coming around, fellowship from house to house. Get a good friend. Excuse me. Allergies. Get a good sister, if you're a sister, or a brother, if you're a brother. And talk to them about the Lord. Pray with them. Encourage one another as we see these things happening. I wouldn't tell you to go to a building, though. That was for free. Wasn't in my notes. No compromise Christianity. A true non-compromising believer will not conform to the things of this world. The Bible says to be carnally minded or worldly minded is death in Romans 8:6. In Romans 8:29 through 30, it says, "For whom God foreknew, God chose his people in advance. He also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, so that his son would be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. Moreover, whom he predestined, these he also called. Whom he called, these he also justified. And whom he justified, these he also glorified." Romans 12:2 says, you're going to get a lot of scripture tonight. I hope you have your Bible open. If not, shame on you. Get your Bible. Come on. If you're online, which you probably are because you got to watch this online, pull up the eSword. Get an eSword on your computer. That way you can follow with me. Romans 12:2 says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. By getting in that word, your mind will get renewed from all the garbage that was got in there all these years. I know, I had a lot of garbage in my mind. And sometimes we talk about stuff and I'm like, I don't remember that. And I'm serious, I don't remember it. Maybe I don't want to remember it. There's some things I do remember that I wish I didn't have to remember. But we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony, and we love not our life to the death. We want to use the word of God. We want to share our testimony. By sharing our testimony, we'll help somebody else that might be where we were. Whenever someone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. We've been blinded to the truth. Let's take a look at that. 2 Corinthians 3. 2 Corinthians 3, 16 to 18. Nevertheless, when it shall turn, okay, wait one second, let me back up. I'm going to start at 13. "And not as Moses, which put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of the which was abolished, but their minds were blinded, for until this day remaineth the same veil untaken away," that's verse 14, "in the reading of the Old Testament, which veil is done away in Christ. But even unto this day, when Moses is read, the veil is upon their heart. Nevertheless, when it shall turn to the Lord, the veil is taken away. The Lord opens our eyes, and it's like, wow, why didn't I see that before? Oh my goodness, look at what I've been doing. Yeah. Yeah. No time for messing around right now. There's no time for doing it your way. No time. If your house is on fire, well, I'm going to say it like I saw a sign down the block at an on fire Methodist church. Unbelievable. But yeah, there's one right around the corner from my house. The pastor is nuts. I love her. Yeah, it's a her. It says on the sign, if you think Florida's hot, you better repent, because hell is a lot hotter. I've never seen preaching like that coming from the pulpit there till she got there. Hey, there's neither male nor female. You know, somebody's going to get mad at me for saying this because it says a bishop should be the husband of one wife. But if you look at what a bishop is, it's a Catholic term. Okay, I'll just go there. I don't have time to break down that scripture right now. I know Shepherdess Sadie is a pastor in her church. She preaches undefiled truth. Okay, so if this woman was set there and she's teaching the truth, me and her were talking about the Sabbath. Why not? Why not? Some of the men out there need to get off your tuff and start preaching the truth. Because I'd rather sit in front of this female pastor out here at the Methodist Church than in front of John Hagee, who's lying. Okay? Listen to those that have the truth. The truth will make you free. Enough compromise. Number two, they love the Lord their God with all their heart, their soul, their mind, and their strength. 1 Chronicles 28:9 through 10 says, worship and serve the Lord with your whole heart and with a willing mind. Oh, I'm just going to do this because my wife or my husband does. Yeah, I just wanted to shut up, so I'll pray tonight. Yeah, he just, you know, I'll just say yes, yeah, but I don't believe a thing he's saying. God knows what's in your heart. Get that heart right. Worship and serve the Lord with a whole heart and with a willing mind, for the Lord sees every heart and understands, listen to this, and knows every plan and thought. I'm going to go to the altar and repeat after him, and then we're going out. We're going to smoke some crack tonight. No. I met a sweet young lady in the store today when I went shopping. If you're listening tonight, Rach, I love you. I really do. And I'm so blessed by the woman of God you've become. And she said to me, sometimes when she's driving back and forth to work, she thinks about, what if ISIS is in the neighborhood? What if they blow something up and I'm there and I die? She goes, I don't want to burn in hell. And I said, and even more so, you want to be with the Lord. And she had me talking about when Bernadette died, what Jesse, my son, saw, because he was in the car with her. And she's like, oh, what did he see? Eight different colors of angels? Oh my, and then she had to go back to work. We'll talk again. I love you, Rachel, if you're listening. I really do. And I'll be there for you. Always have, known you for years. And I'm blessed by what I see in your life right now. I really am. Hold on. Hold on, sweetie pie. Now's not the time to waver, as you told me. Thank you, Lord, for that ordained meeting. Matthew 10:37 through 39 says, Jesus said, this was in the red, If you love your father or mother more than you love me, you are not worthy of being mine. Or if you love your son or daughter more than me, you're not worthy of being mine. If you refuse to take up your cross and follow me, you're not worthy of being mine. If you cling to your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for me, you will find it. Them's heavy-duty words from the Lord. He should be number one in our life. Mark 12:30 says, the Lord Jesus, he said, Yeshua said, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. Here's another one. Let's check ourselves out and see if we're in the faith. The Word of God says we're supposed to see if we be in the faith. See if you complement these scriptures, if these are true in your life. If not, it's, don't worry. Go to Him. Get alone with the Lord, either now or later. Tonight, not tomorrow. If you wanted to finish the program, fine. If you wanted to go, if you're convicted right now, turn it off and get on your knees. And cry out to the Lord, to Teshuvah. That's true repentance. It's coming home. Turning back to God with all of your heart. A change of heart. If we have a change of heart, we won't go back to sinning. If we have a change of heart, we won't be the person we were. I know what I'm talking about. Trust me. And we'll be quick to repent if the thoughts come into our mind and not act them out. It's when we act them out that they become sin. It's when you dwell upon that thought that it becomes sin. Casting down every imagination and everything that exalts itself over the Word of God. And bringing every thought into captivity to the Word. Every thought, is this of God? No, I'm not thinking, I'm not going there, I'm not doing this. So they're separating themselves from all ungodliness and the things of this world. Is that you? Come out from their midst and be ye separate, says the Lord. Let's go to 2 Corinthians 6:17. Jump down to chapter 6. I'm hoping I can get to all of this tonight. I'm going to back up. I'm going to back up. 2 Corinthians 6:14 says, be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship has righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness? And what concord hath Christ with Belial? Or what part hath he that believeth with an infidel? And what agreement hath the temple of God? We're the temple of the Lord. Okay, if you're born again, His Holy Spirit lives in you. So what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? Anything could be an idol. TV, you know, if you're watching perversion. Music, if it's polluted. Drugs, we know that without even asking. Food can be an idol. Our mother or father can be an idol. A sister or brother can be an idol. A pastor can be an idol. What agreement had the temple of God with idols? Don't put nobody before Him. For ye are the temple of the living God. As God had said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Wherefore, this is verse 17, listen to this. Wherefore, come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you, and will be a father unto you. And ye shall be my sons and my daughters, says the Lord God Almighty. I don't know about you, but I want that, and I need that in my life. David said it wonderfully in Psalm 101, verses 2 through 8. I will be careful to live a blameless life. I will lead a life of integrity in my own home. I will refuse to look at anything vile and vulgar. I hate all who deal crookedly. I'll have nothing to do with them. I will reject perverse ideas and stay away from every evil. I will not tolerate people who slander their neighbors. I will not endure conceit and pride. I will search for faithful people to be my companions. Only those who are above reproach will be allowed to serve me. I will not allow deceivers to serve in my house, and liars will not stay in my presence. My daily task will be to ferret out the wicked and free the city of the Lord from their grip. I hope that's your desire tonight. Thank you, Lord. They're walking down the road of God's holiness because they're God's holy remnant. Without holiness, no one shall see God, in Hebrews 12:14 it says. In Leviticus 11:44, see, we believe the Bible from front cover to back. We don't throw away the Old Testament, okay? That's the Torah and Tanakh. They're valid for this time. You must be holy, for I am holy. He didn't say if you want to be. You must be holy, for I am holy. Well, I can't be holy. I'm only living in a fleshly body. Come on now. That excuse has lived for how many years in that fleshly body? Isn't it time that you put that excuse to rest and start consecrating yourself to the Lord? Miss Patricia, been thinking about that a lot. Stop complaining, stop whining. You know, yeah, you're in pain, but you know, does it do any good to complain? No. Does it bring up everybody else's attitude in the home? No. So hush, hush, Patty. There's a lot of people. I'm going to go there. There's a lot of people who complain constantly. I see it on Facebook. Next time you feel like complaining on Facebook, shut your Facebook off. Get your Bible. Go read some of the Psalms. One thing about David, he started out upset, forlorn, hurt, whining. But before you get to the end of the psalm, he's praising the Lord and thanking him. Don't put everything on Facebook. Come on, people. You want to be an encourager, put that on there. And get with a friend, someone you trust, and lay your burdens with them, knowing that they'll pray. I have two sisters that I do that with. One of them's in the chat room. Thank you, Lord. I'm just looking through my scriptures. 2 Corinthians 7:1 says, Let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. Be right back. Oh, my nose. Okay. They do not watch worldly, lustful, evil TV, movies, websites, internet, pornography, filthy computer games, gross, bloody, murderous computer games. Things that are contrary to the God's word. To God's word. They have stopped loving this world. They have stopped loving this evil world. Psalm 101, 2 through 8 says, I will be careful to live a blameless life. I will live a life of integrity in my own home. I will refuse to look at anything vile or vulgar. I hate all who deal crookedly. I know we read that. It's important. David actually hated those that did wickedly. Oh, we know it's the spirits that are working through them nowadays. We know that. We know a little bit more than he did. He was on the right path. Perfect? No. But David had a heart after God. The Bible says that. Through all the messes he did, God said that he, David, had a heart after God. You have a heart after God? You're running after him? Are you knowing that he's all you need? And seeking him early? Put away that sin. Put away anything that does so easily beset you, that turns you away from the truth and living holy and righteous before a holy and righteous God. It's not worth it. It's not worth it. Jesus says in Matthew 5, 27 and 28, that you've heard the commandment that says you must not commit adultery, but I say anyone who even looks at a woman to lust has already committed adultery in her heart, or his heart. Adulterers will not inherit the kingdom of God. Let's look at 1 Corinthians 6, 9 through 10. It goes with the scripture I just read in Matthew 27, 28. It says, don't you realize that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Don't be fooled. Don't deceive yourselves. Those who indulge in sexual sin, or who worship idols, or commit adultery, or are male prostitutes, or practice homosexuality, or are thieves, greedy, drunkards, abusive, cheaters, none of these will inherit the kingdom of God. And bad company corrupts good character. Be careful who you're hanging out with. You might be doing the right thing the whole time, and then all of a sudden, pow. Don't let peer pressure get to you. Romans 8:6 says, to be carnally minded is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus. I'm going to read one more in that area. James 4:4. You adulterers, don't you realize that friendship with the world makes you an enemy of God? I say it again. If you want to be a friend of the world, you make yourself an enemy of God. Looking at this pastor and he's into AC/DC and perverted stuff. Why? You're a role model for all those young people. I messaged him yesterday. You go to them one-on-one if you see things happening. If they don't listen, you bring someone with you. If they won't listen, you bring another person. And if they still don't listen, then you rebuke them to everyone and make an example, the Bible says, that others will fear and stop. I'm not going to let somebody that's deceiving young people . Secular music does not belong in God's house. What does Proud Mary have to do? I ain't saying the name of the church right now. I'm waiting. What does that song have to do with praise and worship? What if you had a visitor that day? Help us, Lord. Hopefully the young people will wise up. Psalm 19:14 says, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. David sang to himself psalms and hymns. Philippians 5:19 says, then you will sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs among yourselves, making music to the Lord in your hearts. This is my favorite one in John 4:23-24. Yeshua said, but the time is coming and is already here when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. The Father is looking for anyone who will worship him that way. For God is a spirit, so those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. I remember a few times that I took some secular kind of folkish songs. I took the words out that were praising the world and I switched them out. I think Brother Larry did this too. And it was fun. Switched them out with words from the Lord's scripture. I think that's awesome. Be careful. Be careful. Do you drool over? Miss Patricia, you're getting out there. I'm going to say it anyway. Do you drool over idols? Oh, wow, that movie star. Oh, wow, that singer. If only I could touch them. Oh, can I get their autograph? God is a jealous God. Hadassah, don't bite my foot. My cat's under the desk. God is a jealous God. He don't want no idols over him. You don't want nobody worshiping anything above him. And a lot of these movie stars are into Satanism and singers. Want more information? Message me at thewatchmanonthewall@gmail.com or patricia@wtvoradio.com. Message me. I'll send you the information you want. 1 Corinthians 6:9-10 says, don't you realize that unrighteousness will not inherit the kingdom of God? Don't fool yourselves. Don't fool yourselves. Those who worship idols, they're getting married 1 week with one person, the next week with another person, busted for drugs. I mean, why are you drooling over these people? pray for them, that they might come to the Lord. That would be better. Matthew 23:12 says, "But those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those that humble themselves will be exalted." Don't be honoring the wicked. Amen. Here's another one. They don't partner up with unbelievers and those who compromise their walk with Jesus. Oh yeah, I'm a true believer of God. Hey, you want to go out and get high tonight? Be careful. It will rub off on you. Now, if you're a strong believer and you want to be a witness to this person, fantastic. We need people that are witness to the lost, but make sure you're praying, make sure you're fasting, make sure you're being very, and you're not a baby in the Lord. Make sure that you've been listening to his voice and following him for years. That way you'll stand. I was talking to a precious sister before the program and message. She hears the Lord. She knows his voice. And she's a good witness for the Lord just by the way she lives. Amen. They pursue pure and godly friendships that inspire them to be more like Jesus. They display Christ-likeness in their thoughts and attitudes. It's kind of like a beatitude attitude. I like that beatitude attitude. They are humble and have childlike faith. Unless you turn and become like a child, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Whoever humbles himself like a child is the greatest in the kingdom of God. Amen. Amen. Don't let anyone lead you astray with empty philosophy and high-sounding nonsense that comes from human thinking, from the evil powers of this world and not Christ. They refuse to be lukewarm, having one foot in the world and one foot in the Word. Enough with the lukewarm. If the Lord allowed us to see what's a year or two down the road, or even a month or two down the road. There's a lot of talk about this fall. I'm just going to see what happens. I'm not going to go off on that. I am going to go off on telling you to repent and live holy in case the world goes nuts this fall. Make sure you're right with the Lord. That's what I'm here for. That's what the Watchman on the Wall started back in 2009, I think I was with another company, another radio production. I've been on the wall crying, repent, for more than 5, 6, 7 years on the radio. But since 1985, when I got saved, when I came to the Lord, I could not shut my mouth. Because I love you, that's why. If I didn't love you, I would not say anything. I would not encourage you to walk holy before your God. I would not reach out at every chance I get and warn you about the things that are going on. I've got to tell you. Now's the time to repent. They refuse lukewarmness, having one foot in the Word, one foot in the world. They seek to please the Lord through good deeds and having a servant's heart. Excuse me 1 minute. be a server instead of wanting to be served. They know that financial gain does not mean godliness. Not at all. It's not money that's the root of all evil. It's the love of money that's the root of all evil. Be careful. We need money to live, to pay our bills, to be a blessing to others. We don't need 3-4 cars and 2-3 houses. They seek first the kingdom, not worldly wealth and possessions, and they're content. Let's look at Philippians 4:11. Go 4:11. Paul said, "Now that I speak in respect of want," Philippians 4:11, "for I have learned in whatsoever state I am therewith to be content. I know both how to be abased, I know how to abound. Everywhere and in all things I am instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need." And then he says, okay, people just take scriptures out of context. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. But what does it say before? Are you walking happy in whatever situation you find yourself in? I slept on a park bench for about six, seven months I slept on a park bench. I didn't know the Lord. Thank you, Father, for protection. But what about now? Remember I told you I worked for Sprint? I got laid off in March of 2011. Went from making $5,000 a month to making nothing. I've learned how to be abased and how to be abound. How to be happy with a little bit. He said he provided all of our needs according to his riches, not all of our wants. Be happy with what you have. The Lord will bless you. Our first priority isn't to get wealth. Our first priority is to lead the lost and dying world to the Lord. They'd rather suffer and be poor and not compromise with the world than be rich and famous. We're getting to a point where you won't even be able to buy nor sell unless you join in with the world. I'd rather lose everything I have than to lose my soul. Settle that within your life tonight. You might have to make a decision. They are generous and are givers, whether they are poor or have much. Hey, fill up a basket with water and peanut butter sandwiches and go out. Feed some poor people. You know where they live. You don't have to be rich in order to help those that are living underneath the L or living in downtown Orlando. Now some people are getting arrested over here for feeding the poor. Be really discreet how you're doing it, okay? See a little old lady in the supermarket. This is what I love doing. I'm saying it for God's glory, okay? and they're looking through their change purse to try to get the rest of their money to pay their for their little bit of groceries, just tell them, go ahead, I've got it, I've got it. Don't take their money, tell the lady behind the register. You see somebody putting in $3 in their gas tank, go over there, fill up their tank for them. Or at least $5-$10 if you can't fill it up. Tell them about the Lord. Every excuse to witness Christ. Yep. That's the life we're supposed to live, Diane. Letting God use us. Diane has said in the chat room that she sees it often. She works at Key Food in Queens, Richmond Hill, Queens. And she sees a lot going on. They are surrendering all to follow Jesus, taking up their cross daily. The cross before me and the world behind me. No turning back. No turning back. One day I'm going to get you on here with me, Diane. I'm going to get you hooked up to Skype and get you on here with me. You got a lot of testimonies that I want shared. It'll bless people. For sure. Here's another one. They stop practicing sin. And when they do sin, there is deep sorrow. When they do mess up, they're like, David, I've sinned against God and in His sight. Father. And their heart is broken. And they have to stop. If you're convicted by what you're doing, and you don't repent there on the spot, your heart will get colder and colder, and it'll be easier and easier to sin. We're in the Word tonight. I'm not jumping up and down. I'm not shouting crazy. I'm telling you, it's time to get right with God. They speak out and warn people about God's coming judgments and preach the gospel. Wow. Let's look at 2 Timothy 4, 2-4. 2 Timothy, here we go, 4. I love 2 and 1 Timothy. Preach the word. Be instant in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all love suffering, all long suffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. And they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables. And then he exhorts again, but watch thou in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist. Make full proof of thy ministry. We're all called. We're all called to share the gospel. I'm going to put a song on, and I'll be right back. It's by Keith Green, one of my favorites. No Compromise. Enjoy.
You want me to go empty words and no white lies, no token prayers, no compromise. I want to shine the light you gave through your Son. You said to save us from ourselves and our despair. It comforts me to know you're really for. I live and share the hope you gave to me. I want to share the love that set me free.
Yes, we're still live. We're still live, Sister Kelly. Hit the button in the middle. Okay. Alrighty, welcome. Diane, meet Kelly. She's my other sister that I trust. Diane used to babysit John and Bernadette, my two children from a long time ago. And she's truly a blessing, and I'm glad I found her on Facebook. She loves the Lord so much. You guys should be friends. Get friends on Facebook, yeah. But let me go back to my notes. We're talking about compromise tonight. There we go. We're talking about compromise tonight. Let me go back to my notes. Very important teaching tonight. We need to walk upright before a holy God. So much is going on. Wickedness, perversion. The line has been drawn in the sand. If we don't stand for the Lord right now, we won't be able to one day. If we keep making excuses for our sin, when everything starts hitting the fan, and it's gonna very shortly, we won't be able to stand. If you can't take the insults of a neighbor or a school friend, people on your job, because you won't put that stuff before your eyes, because you won't go bar hopping with them anymore, because you won't smoke that joint no more, you won't get high no more, you won't get drunk no more. If you can't say no now, you won't say no when they say, take the mark or you'll die. In fact, are you obeying God's commandments? If you're not obeying His commandments, you've already taken a mark. The Sabbath is a sign, the Bible says, between Him and His bride. That's the fourth commandment, and it's the seventh day of the week, not the first. Let's go to the next one. They suffer persecuting and beatings for standing up for Jesus, the voice of the martyrs. Christopher Manti preaches. He shows us what's going on in those countries, Mondays at 5 o'clock Eastern Time. He works. He's a regional worker for the voice of the martyrs here in the United States. People are being beheaded, skinned alive, raped, beat, because they declare the name Jesus. Because they declare the name Yeshua. Messianics are being killed too. Let's go to John 10 and 20. A little longer than usual, I know, but that's okay. Jesus said, therefore, Doth my Father love me because I lay down my life that I might take it again? No man taketh from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. And this commandment have I received of my Father. And there was a division, therefore, against among the Jews for these sayings. And many of them said, He hath the devil, and he's mad. Why hear ye him? And others said, These are not words of him. They hath the devil. Can a devil open up the eyes of the blind? They thought Jesus had a devil. Don't worry about what people say about you. It doesn't matter what they say. Let's go to Hebrews 10. Are you learning this in church? Or are you learning a feel-good message? God wants you to have your best life now. No, God wants you to be persecuted. He wants you to suffer so he can purify you. In this life, you will have you will have suffering. But be of good cheer, for I've overcome this world. Didn't he say that? In this life, you will, in this world, you will have suffering. You will have persecution. Patty paraphrased, I know. But it's the same thing. He didn't say in this life you're going to have your best life now. And I'll tell you, if I see one more post that says, share this if you want a blessing today, give me a break. Share this if you want to be blessed today. 7 days from today, you'll have a blessing. No, you won't. That's a lie from the pit of hell. Sounds like fortune telling. Okay. That was the scripture. Okay. Hebrews 10, 32 and 34. Okay. For we know him that hath said, Vengeance belongeth unto me. I'm starting here on 30. I will recompense, saith the Lord, and again the Lord shall judge his people. It's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of a living God. But call to remembrance the former days, in which after ye were illuminated, ye endured a great flight of afflictions, partly while ye were made a gazing stock, both by reproaches and afflictions, and partly whilst ye became companions of them that were so used. For ye had compassion of me in my bonds, Paul said, and took joyfully the spoiling of your goods, knowing in yourselves that ye have in heaven a better and enduring substance. So cast not away therefore your confidence, which has great recompense of reward. For ye have need of patience, that after ye have done the will of God, ye might receive the promise. For yet a little while, and he shall come. Will come and will not tarry. Now the just shall live by faith, but if any man draws back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. But we are not of them who draw back unto perdition, but of them that believe to the saving of the soul. You can lose your salvation. Hey, Brother Larry. Hey, Pastor Rick. You can lose your salvation. What else do real non-compromisers do? They will love and do good to their fellow believers. They'll even love those that are hateful towards them. I'm going to turn to Matthew 25. looks like a good one. Matthew 25:31. Hope you have your Bible with you, or your Esau. 25. We're in the Word tonight, Brother Larry. As it should be. When the Son of Man shall come in his glory, and all the holy angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory. And before him shall be gathered all nations, and he shall separate them one from another, as a shepherd divideth his sheep from the goats. And he shall set the sheep on his right hand, but the goats on his left. And then shall the king say unto them on his right hand, Come ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundations of the world. For I was hungered, and you gave me meat. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you took me in. Naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came unto me. And then shall the righteous answer him, saying, Lord, when saw we thee a hungered, and fed thee, or thirsty, and gave thee drink? When saw we thee a stranger, and took thee in, or naked, and clothed thee? Or when saw we thee sick, or in prison, and came unto thee? And the king, Yeshua, Jesus, shall answer and say unto them, Verily I say unto you, inasmuch as ye have done it unto the one of the least of my brethren, you have done it unto me. And then shall he say also unto them on the left hand, Depart. For the devil and his angels. For I was hungered, and you gave me no meat. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. You see what I'm saying here? He wants us to reach out to those. I was sleeping on a park bench in Rocky Point, Long Island, when everything happened in my life. This is before I knew the Lord. And Irene took me in. She helped me. Gave me clothes on my back, took off the smelly ones, helped me get cleaned up, helped me find a job, helped me find my own place, and that's how I met my husband, going on 35 years married, 8-1, August 1st. She took me in. Thank you, Father. Wasn't too long after that. Went through some hell. Oh yeah, I did, like Diane knows, she knows me. But on July 27, 1985, at 7:30 in the morning, before my car hit the guardrail on the Northern State Parkway, I fell asleep. And the Lord, Yahweh, my Heavenly Father, shouted, Patty, wake up! When I got home, I cried out to the Lord, and He delivered me. I was a whore. I was a drug addict. I was a drunk. There was no good in me at all. And I owe it to Him. That's why I'm here before you tonight, crying for you to turn to Teshuvah. Go home to the Lord. Allow Him to change that heart of yours. Cry out to Him in repentance. If I had died that night, I would have lifted up my eyes in hell. I would have been cast into a lake of fire that wasn't prepared for me. Is that you tonight? You don't know if you have tomorrow. None of us do. Tonight, drop to your knees. Get along with the Lord. He already knows what you're doing. And there's no sin too big that He can't forgive. I know that for a fact. Allow Him. Allow Him to work in your heart tonight. For I was a stranger and you took me in. Naked and you clothed me. sick and in prison, and you visited me not. This is Stu Yeshua talking. Then shall they also answer him, saying, Lord, when saw we thee a hungered or a thirst, a stranger or naked or sick or in prison, and did not minister unto thee? Then shall he say to them, Verily I say unto you, inasmuch as you did it not to one of the least of these, you did it not to me. And these shall go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into life eternal. This is not a game. This is not a joke. This is your eternal soul. Get off that fence. It's not worth it. It's not worth it. Oh yeah, sin was great. Felt great. I loved getting high. Fooled around all over the place with the bands and all. I was, hey, Diane, you remember. Diane's mother used to pray for me. Found that out a few days ago. Somebody's praying for you tonight. Here's another thing that they do. They obey God's commandments and His word. They keep His Sabbath day holy, set apart. Let me go over to Revelations, my favorite scriptures. Some of my favorite scriptures are in here. Thank you, Father. Let's go to Revelations 12:17. And the dragon was wroth with the woman. Let's see who he went to make war with. And went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God, and have the testimony of Yeshua, of Jesus Christ. Oh, that's just for the Jewish people. Yeah, but they're not following Jesus. What are you talking about? The commandments are just for the Jewish people. No. They're for all of us. Do you go murder? Do you steal? Are you lying? We can go on and on and on and on. Keep the Sabbath day holy. Set apart. It's a date night between you and the Lord. That's how I look at it. It's a set apart time. It's an appointed time for you and the Lord. Worship 7 days a week. Like Brother Larry even says, go ahead if you want to go visit a church, go to a prayer meeting. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord. Not the first, not the third, not the fifth, the seventh day. Let's go to my next scripture here. Revelations 22:14. Listen closely to this, beloved. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates of the city. Who enters in through the gates of the city? Who has right to the tree of life? Those that do his commandments. Verse 15, for without are dogs and sorcerers and whoremongers and murderers and idolaters and whosoever loveth and maketh a lie. Are the commandments important? Yes, they are. You'll not make it into the kingdom of God without obedience. They're doers of the word, not merely hearers. faith without works is dead. They fear God and turn from evil. We're talking about what do people that don't compromise do? God sees everything you're doing. He saw everything I did. Diane's in the chat room saying she used to run after me and tell me to go home. I didn't listen because I was in love with my sin, Diane. Kelly, you have an eyewitness in the chat room right here. Diane, an eyewitness to what I did. And I don't mind her sharing it. Everything God leads you to share, share it. Don't bother me. Because it brings glory to God that I'm not there or doing that anymore. Here's another one. They're not people pleasers, but seek to please the Lord. If you don't like me, I really don't care. Put it that way. Flip the channel. I'm seeking to obey my Father. And he said, call people out of compromise tonight. They are not hypocrites, giving God mere lip service. They don't honor him with their lips, and their heart is far removed. You ever see people like that? They can do a prayer at a pinch, but they don't spend any time with them. How do you know? Because their mouth is filthy. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Jesus replied, you hypocrites. Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you. For he wrote, these people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship. Their worship is a farce, for they teach man-made ideas and commands from God. For you ignore God's laws and substitute your own tradition. And then he said, you skillfully sidestep God's law in order to hold on to your tradition. So you cancel the word of God in order to hand down your own tradition. And that's Mark 7:16, 6 through 13. You know, in Amos, the Lord says that I hate all you show and pretend, the hypocrisy of your religious festivals and your solemn assemblies. I will not accept your burnt offering or your grain offerings. I won't even notice all your choice peace offerings. Away with your hymns of praise. They are only noise to my ears. I will not listen to your music, no matter how lovely it is. Instead, I want to see a mighty flood of justice, a river of righteous living that will never run dry. The Lord is seeking after worshipers. He's seeking after your heart, a pure heart and undefiled. He will no way cast out. They pray fervent prayers and pray often with other believers. They share their burdens one with another. And please, be careful. Don't share your burdens with everybody. I have four people that I know that I'll share my burdens with. Three of them in the chat room right now. I won't tell everybody everything. Nelson, you're the other one. I don't trust everybody. And rightly so. Be careful who you confide in. That was a little bit of extra right there. They study God's word. They make disciples. They share his word with others. Don't get nervous. Study his word. And you know something? The Lord even said, don't worry about what you're going to say when they deliver you up, when you're in front of some people that are starting with you. Don't worry. But I will put my words in your mouth, he said. And he's done that several times in my life. Don't worry. Just obey him. They're winning their battle against sin and keeping the full armor of God on, enduring hardships, sufferings, and trials through Christ. Ephesians 6:10 through 20. I'm going to read that. This is long. I usually go an hour. Well, tough. This is what the Lord wanted. He said, go ahead. I said, oh, Lord. He said, go ahead. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, take in the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. And take the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto, with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. And for me, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am ambassador in bonds, and therein I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. Thank you, Lord. They are ready, waiting, and eager to anticipating the return of the Lord. Oh, we have to go through many things before he's coming back, for sure. But they're not afraid of his return. They love his commandments, reading his word daily, memorizing scripture. They use every opportunity that they can to share his word. Are you being persecuted for righteousness' sake? Well, you're co-heirs with Christ, and you will share in the sufferings of Jesus. You got to crucify that flesh. They understand God's eternal purpose for his people versus the temporal evil world. They know that they're merely passing through the world, and their real home is with the Lord. And they do everything for the glory of God. They don't believe in false teachings and anything that's contrary to the word. They won't tolerate it. And they clearly understand the gospel. And they clearly preach it with boldness. There's no confidence that they put in the flesh. They decrease, and Christ increases. They have integrity at work. They're hardworking, pursuing righteousness without lying and stealing and cheating. And they're always thankful to God for his kindness, his provisions, and his protection, among a few things. O wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? I thank God through Christ our Lord. They're not full of self-ambition, strife, quarreling, jealousy, but they're peacemakers. They acknowledge and embrace and obey God's sovereign will for their life. No prejudice. The Lord loves us all equal. There's no skin color or nationality that he loves more than the other. And they don't allow the cares and worries of this life to dominate their mind and its conversations. Sounds hard, huh? But it's really not hard. He's got a plan and a purpose for us. Father, I thank you for what you're doing here tonight. Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you, Father God, for the lives that you're touching worldwide even now. Thank you for your patience with us, Lord, for your long-suffering with us, for your love towards us when we were yet sinners. Thank you, Father, for making provisions to draw us to you. And there was hard things that you allowed in our life to get our attention. But we thank you for those things, Lord. Father, I ask right now that those that have heard this message from you, that they will apply it tonight and going forward. Getting into your word, Lord. Honoring your word, Father. Living it out in daily life and sharing it with others. The hope of glory. So many have no hope. But we have you, Lord. I thank you, Father God, for touching hearts tonight. I thank you, Lord, for that. Thank you for your love and your guidance and the conviction of your Holy Spirit. We will listen to your voice going forward and obey. We pray all these things, B'Shem Yeshua, in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. You've been listening to Miss Patricia, Hope in the Night, on CMV TV. We'll see you back on Friday night at 9 p.m. Tonight was no compromise. Friday night will be the compromising church and what to look for. I'm going to leave you with this song by Twyla Paris called I Will Listen. Good night. Hard as it seems.
is the dreamer now.